and welcome to the recorded version of the webinar titled New Opportunities for School Nurse Leaders to Engage in Health, Prevention, and Wellness. This webinar was hosted by the National Association of School Nurses and Trust for America's Health. So let's join the webinar as our moderator is in the process of introducing our first speaker, Donna Mazyck.
In community-based settings. For nearly 20 years, her career focus has been on school health. Donna began her school health career as a high school nurse, and most recently, she worked as a state school nurse consultant at the Maryland State Department of Education. Donna served as president of the National Association of School Nurses from 2007 to 2009. Her formal education includes a Bachelor of Science degree in nursing from the University of Pennsylvania and a Master of Science degree in counseling from Loyola University in Maryland. She is nationally certified in school nursing and counseling. Donna is also a licensed clinical professional counselor. She enjoys advancing leadership of school nurses who in turn facilitate student well-being and success. We are delighted to have Jeff Levi join us today as well. Jeff is the Executive Director of the Trust for America's Health, where he leads the organization's advocacy efforts on behalf of a modernized public health system. He oversees TFOS work on a range of public health policy issues, including implementation of the public health provisions of the Affordable Care Act and annual reports assessing the nation's public health preparedness, investment in public health infrastructure, and response to chronic diseases such as obesity. In January of 2011, President Obama appointed Dr. Levi to serve as a member of the Advisory Group on Prevention, Health Promotion, and Integrative and Public Health. And in April of 2011, Surgeon General Benjamin appointed him chair of the advisory group. Dr. Levi is also professor of health policy at George Washington University School of Public Health, where his research has focused on HIV/AIDS, Medicaid, and integrating public health with the healthcare delivery system. He has also served as an associate editor of the American Journal of Public Health and as deputy director of the White House Office of National AIDS Policy. Dr. Levi received a BA from Oberlin College, an MA from Cornell University, and a PhD from the George Washington University. And finally, Sara Zeigler will wrap things up for us today. Sara is currently serving as the Acting Associate Director for Policy and Partnerships for the Division of Community Health. Sara joined CDC in 2002 after spending nearly 5 years working with nonprofit, community-based, and educational organizations. During Sara's tenure at CDC, she spent 4 years in CDC's Division of Cancer Prevention and Control as a project officer and advancing national partnership efforts. Additionally, Sara worked in CDC's Office of the Director, serving as the policy lead for CDC's Biosurveillance Coordination Unit and for the Appropriations Account Managers with the Financial Management Office. Sara also served as the Deputy Branch Chief for the Research Application and Surveillance and Evaluation Research Branches within the Division of Adolescent and School Health. Sara has a Master's Degree in Public Administration from the Maxwell School of Public Affairs and Citizenship at Syracuse University and a Bachelor's Degree in Leadership Studies from the University of Richmond. Now, before we go ahead and start the presentations, kicking it off with Donna, we'd like to do a very brief 30-second poll. Let's see if I can get this going. On your screen, you should see a quick poll, and I encourage you to answer the question, and then we will show you the results. I'll give you about 20 more seconds. Okay. Okay, and it's time to close the poll. So it looks like a lot of you are on here to learn more about what exactly the Prevention and Public Health Fund and the National Prevention Strategy and Community Transformation Grants are all about. We hope that today's webinar will be quite informative. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Donna Mazyck, the Executive Director at the National Association of School Nurses. Donna, whenever you're ready, you can go ahead.
Angela.
There we go. Hi, Donna. Thank you.
Hi, Angela. Thank you. And we're very grateful for our guest today, who will teach us a lot more about the National Prevention Strategy. At NASN, we know that school nurses are at the forefront of providing care coordination for students with chronic health conditions. But we also know that school nurses provide population health in a variety of ways, including dealing with immunizations, various health screenings, and their work with school wellness committees. NASN's strategic plan begins with our mission, which is to advance the specialty practice of school nursing to improve the health and academic success of all students. Strategic areas in the NASN strategic plan include advocacy, public relations, programs and services, as well as research. But I want to focus on one NASN strategic goal. And this goal is found in the area of research. NASN will be an authority on evidence-based school nursing practice. One of the outcomes we're looking for is to expand and disseminate comprehensive literature reviews so that school nurses would have evidence-based information about school health interventions, processes, outcomes, and programs for disease prevention and health promotion. We're also looking within that strategic goal to promote the role of the school nurse in translating health reform into the school setting. And that brings us to where we are today and the information that we are bringing to you today. We're excited to know that as partners in prevention, school nurses are focused on improving the health of students. Now, the National Prevention Strategy, which you will hear more about, seeks to increase the number of Americans who are healthy at every stage of life. And school nurses are working to improve the health of those who are ages 0 to 21. The intersection of NASN's strategy and the National Prevention Strategy connects around the vision of moving the nation from a focus on sickness and disease to one based on prevention and wellness. The work that school nurses do includes the 7 priorities of the National Prevention Strategy, and I did list them here around the central goal of improving the health of students. And Jeff and Sara will note that I adapted 2 of the priorities for the work that school nurses do in the population that they work with, and that drug use and alcohol prevention for those under 21 is what we work towards as school nurses, and health education and sexuality education are what we focus on as well. And I'm sure that school nurses on this call will find some of the work that they do around this circle that intends to improve the health of children. So today, NASN is grateful to partner with Trust for America's Health and the CDC's Division of Community Health in order to bring school nurses vital information on this prevention and wellness focus. So right now, I'll turn it over to Dr. Jeff Levy from the Trust for America's Health.
Thank you so much, Donna. And Jeff, whenever you're ready, please go ahead.
All right. And the question is whether you can actually see my, so I need to check whether you're able to see what I am seeing now. Can you see my screen?
We can see it, but if you can go into your slideshow mode, that would be great.
There
we go.
Is that better?
Thank you.
Okay. Got the technology down. So thank you, Donna, and I'm really delighted to be here. And you know, the irony of, especially in hearing, in being reminded through Donna's opening remarks, is that what I'm about to tell you about is really about how the world of health, public health, and policy making is catching up with what school nurses already know and are already doing. Because if you think about what is sort of the philosophical underpinning about everything both Sara and I are going to be talking about, it's really about this concept that to create health, to make sure that people and kids are as healthy as they can be, that we have to think about not just what happens in the clinical setting, which is incredibly important, but also what surrounds that clinical setting, whether it's in the school, whether it's in the home, or whether it's in the broader community. And that's really what the National Prevention Strategy, what the Prevention Public Health Fund, and what the Community Transformation Grants are all trying to do to move our system to a true health care system rather than a sickness-focused system. So Trust for America's Health is a nonprofit organization. We're dedicated to saving lives in every community and working to make disease prevention a national priority. I like to say that we do evidence-based advocacy work. We try to make the case based on the evidence, based on the science, based on best practices for the programs and the investments that we support primarily at the federal level. The Affordable Care Act is probably best known and appropriately best known, I guess, for the investment and the change in how we assure access to third-party payment for health care, whether it's expansion of access to private insurance or access to Medicaid. But there is something else underpinning the Affordable Care Act that is critical in what we're going to be talking about today, which is that we're not talking about just the absence of disease, but also creating health, whether it's through clinical preventive services like vaccines and screenings, many of which are offered in a school setting, but also creating an environment where society has a responsibility to help individuals exercise their personal responsibility to be as healthy as we can be and to make the healthy choices the easy choices. I'd like to say that this is just a philosophical recognition of the importance of these kinds of investments and this kind of approach, but it also comes from the reality that chronic diseases, especially those driven by obesity, physical inactivity, and poor nutrition, as well as tobacco, that the chronic diseases that are driven by these three factors, diseases like diabetes and heart disease and cancer, they're the biggest cause of disability, lack of productivity, poor performance in schools, absenteeism in schools, and also very high health costs. And it's those high health costs that I think has caused people to pay closer attention. And we also know that these are diseases that we can manage in the doctor's office, but we also need to prevent them in the community as well as manage them. So a lot of the interventions that focus on disease management, for example, what school nurses do every day in helping kids with chronic asthma or diabetes or whatever other condition manage their conditions, that's more of a community setting, and we need to be supporting that environment and making sure that that happens well in order to reduce emergency department use and hospital admissions. But also when we think about physical activity and better nutrition, you know, those are both preventive measures and they are also disease management measures for a lot of these conditions. And those happen in the community, whether it's by making streets safer or more walkable, whether it means having better access to healthy foods in corner grocery stores or making schools, sure schools, or helping schools offer healthier options. All of those come together to a deal with these very serious challenges in our healthcare system. So the good news is that this notion about prevention is very strongly supported by the American people. You can see here, investing in prevention is supported across party lines, across geographic regions, and also by gender. And you know, what resonates and is particularly important, I think, for nurses and who you work with, is that while everyone believes in personal responsibility, they also believe that there are local initiatives that can be taken to make healthy choices easier. And people truly believe that we have a responsibility as a society to think in an aspirational way about the future of kids. They know that this generation, the public understands that this generation of kids could be the first generation to live shorter, less healthy lives than their parents. But they believe that by investing in the right programs in the right way, that we can indeed turn that around. And for policymakers, it's also important for them to understand that even with relatively small changes in physical activity, nutrition, and tobacco use, we can have a tremendous impact on healthcare costs. Trust for America's Health worked with the Urban Institute, New York Academy of Medicine, and the Prevention Institute to develop a report that tried to assess what those cost savings would be. And with a relatively modest investment across the country, we could see with just a 5% reduction in some of the obesity and tobacco-related health conditions like diabetes and heart disease and some cancers. Actually, cancers would be a smaller reduction. With that one-time reduction in those conditions, we could save $16 billion a year within 5 years. And that's a return of investment of about $5.60 for every dollar invested. You know, we did, more recently, we put out a report that specifically focused on obesity healthcare costs. Again, looking at with relatively modest changes, you see in this chart that we'd save, you know, over $50 billion within 5 years, about $50 billion a year in healthcare costs if we went from that green, at least on my screen, it is a green line, which is the current trajectory of healthcare costs associated with obesity, and gone down 5% in average BMI, which is about 10 pounds, which is that red line, and which is the performance measure for the community transformation grants that Sara Zeigler is going to be talking about. If we did have community transformations in every state in the country reaching everyone at risk, we could see some very dramatic changes in healthcare costs. So that is, in a sense, a background for talking a little bit about the National Prevention Strategy, and Donna did a wonderful job of summarizing it. This was mandated also by the Affordable Care Act. It was designed to it was released in June of last year and was really a product of lots of external input, but really owned by 17 federal agencies who came up with this vision of working together on thinking not just about what government can do, but what individuals and families and communities can do to move from a focus on sickness and disease to one that is based on prevention and wellness. The strategy identified as its goal to increase the health of Americans at every stage of life with four pillars: healthy and safe community environments, clinical and community preventive services, empowered people, and the elimination of health disparity. Now that is those are very, very broad categories, but let me tell you a little bit more about what this means, because it really gets to this concept of it's not just what happens in the clinical system or in even the traditional public health environment. So when we think about healthy and safe communities, we're not just talking about clean air and water. We're also talking about safe and affordable housing. We know how closely tied stable housing is to better health outcomes. We're talking about safe streets, not just to prevent injury as a result of crime, but also when we're talking about having a community feel safer, people will be more active and be able to play outdoors. So when we think about empowered people, we're thinking about creating health literacy. We're thinking about creating getting people more engaged in their lives, and we're thinking about elimination of health disparities. We're also thinking about not just the disparities that occur in the healthcare delivery system, but also socio and economic factors, including completing education, completing high school, as making a really big difference in people's lives. So the prevention strategy really brought together a broad range of agencies. And you see on this slide the 17 offices and agencies that are part of this. And obviously the Department of Education is a major player in all of this. And comes with a recognition that it's not just that the education department and schools have a role to play in promoting better, more physical activity and more prevention activities, but also recognizing that healthier kids do better in school. But it's a broad range of agencies. So Housing and Urban Development recognized here the critical nature of housing to health outcomes. It's the Department of Transportation recognizing that how they construct transportation will make a difference as to whether we are active or not. And it's, you know, the Department of Defense recognizing that we need people who are fitter so that when they are recruiting people for the armed forces, we will do better. The strategy also tries to identify some opportunities for all sectors to play a role. It's a national prevention strategy. It is not just a strategy for government agencies. And so if you go to the National Prevention Strategy, you will see detailed recommendations for what the education sector can do and how they can address these seven priorities that Donna, I think, appropriately adapted for the school setting. So that's the strategy, and behind the strategy is this critically important prevention and public health fund. This is a unique moment for public health and prevention. It is the first time we have a guaranteed funding stream for new and innovative prevention strategies. It's $12.5 billion over the next 10 years. It rises in 2022 to actually $2 billion every year. So over time, it will grow. At the moment, it's at a $1 billion level. And we've been incredibly grateful to the National Association of School Nurses for their support in protecting this fund from some of the ongoing efforts. And unfortunately, we lost a little bit of it in paying for the doctor fix. But we have successfully fought off further attempts to reduce this fund and really protect it for the kinds of investments that you're going to hear about from Sara. The prevention fund is really about making sure that programs like the community transformation grants that Sara will be describing do something to transform our communities into making the healthy choice the easy choice. The Prevention Fund has very broad support from unions, from the medical community, from advocacy groups, from business groups, from faith-based groups, from political leaders across at the local level. So we see this as this leverage, this point of leverage, a real opportunity to make sure that at $1 billion a year, we're growing programs, creating new programs that really bring into practice the vision of the National Prevention Strategy. And I think with that, I will turn it back to and over to Sara Zeigler.
Dr.
Thank you so much, Jeff, for that really wonderful presentation. And now, Sarah, I am going to unmute you and pass the baton whenever you're ready.
Thank you very much. And thank you all very much for your attendance, and Jeff for teeing up very nicely for us the background and the context for a lot of the work that CDC is doing related to our community-based programs preventing chronic diseases. I'm really excited to be able to share information with all of you and be able to help connect the dots for where there's work going on, I think, in a lot of communities near you where you could get involved and be engaged with the work that we're doing to affect the health of our youth. As Jeff has been talking a little bit about the prevention fund, I wanted to make sure you all know that the Affordable Care Act is the legislation that has given us our marching orders. And more specifically, the Prevention and Public Health Fund provides the resources that support CDC's community-based chronic disease prevention initiative. For some reason, my slides aren't advancing, so hold on 1 second. Okay, sorry about the delay. Today I'm going to talk to you about the disease burden in the U.S. and what our children are experiencing in communities that impact their health, provide a brief overview of our program portfolio, highlighting those that focus on school and child health, and address the purpose of our community transformation grant program, including a commitment to the health of our youth. The chronic disease burden has been growing at a breakneck pace, and the impact that it has on all aspects of our lives, not just individual, is enormous. You may already know some of these statistics, but I think they bear repeating. More than half of American adults have at least one chronic illness. Chronic diseases lead to lost productivity, reduced quality of life, and premature death. Indeed, 7 out of 10 deaths in the United States are caused by chronic diseases, including over 2 million heart attacks and strokes occur annually. There continues to be a large gap in clinical preventive services, where 1 in 3 Americans have high blood pressure, a significant risk factor for heart attacks and strokes, yet only 47% have it adequately controlled. This means that roughly 75% of the money spent nationally on healthcare is focused on chronic diseases. In addition, our nation's current generation of the children is the first one expected to live shorter lives than their parents. At CDC, we strive to curtail these trends by supporting communities as they develop and implement initiatives to reduce costly chronic diseases and the associated risk factors that lead to death and disability. CDC's commitment to community health remains as strong as ever. If you take a quick look at the bullets in this slide, you'll see what that entails. We strive for a future where all Americans have access to good, nutritious food, user-friendly environments that encourage physical activity and are free of cancer-causing smoke, access to the systems of clinical care that are critical to keeping us on track for living longer and healthier lives. Specifically, we focus on promoting health in populations that bear the greatest burden of death, disability, and chronic disease. There are critical gaps that need to be addressed to bridge in these communities that will ultimately benefit the entire nation. A core element of maximizing health is ensuring that we use evidence-based strategies. These strategies take many forms, such as policy development, where CDC and our grantees focus on educating the public and stakeholders about sustainable strategies to improve health, or environmental improvement, where we focus on creating social and physical environments that support healthy living, or programmatic improvements, where we increase access to prevention programs that support healthy living, or infrastructure improvements, such as establishing systems, procedures, and protocols within communities and institutions that support healthy behavior. CDC is committed to building and expanding the evidence base that supports best practices in community health. Please keep in mind that policy development has long been a core function of public health. Our work focuses on conducting analysis to identify strategies proven effective in protecting health and preventing disease, educating the public, and implementing these strategies while ensuring that the most people are reached as possible. Of course, lobbying is prohibited with federal funds at the local, state, and federal levels, and we CDC very much ensures that all of our grantees and CDC adhere to federal laws on any of those restrictions. Traditionally, public health has chosen to either focus on programs that reduce health disparities or implement programs that achieve population-wide health impacts. And an example of a health disparity may be a play desert. And by that I mean a community where there are very few safe places for children to play outside and exercise. Just 1 in 5 children in the United States live within a half a mile of a park or playground, or the ability of a place to play looms far worse in low and the ability of a place to play looms far worse in low-income neighborhoods. Population interventions don't necessarily reduce disparities. In theory, these improvements should affect all people equally. But in practice, we've seen some limited success with ensuring the reduction of disparities. For instance, we had some reason to celebrate in New York, where the obesity declined in children K through 8 by 5.5% from 2006 to 2011. However, the rates were varied in different population groups. For instance, there was a reduction for white children of 12.5%, Asian Pacific Islanders of 7.6%, Hispanics of 3.4%, and African Americans of only 1.9%. So in this situation, with population-wide approaches, we saw some reason of success, but also aligning that tells us the disparities that actually widened. So for all of our approaches, we believe that we must address this from a twin approach of thinking about how we have population-wide strategies around the issues that we're addressing, but we also simultaneously work together for targeted intervention to ensure that that all populations will benefit from the access to these health improvement opportunities. For instance, what this might look like is that a twin approach might be in limiting secondhand smoke exposure in a multi-unit housing facility. National data shows that children have an increase of 45% increased level of nicotine byproduct when they live in apartments as opposed to a detached home. This is particularly concerning for our children, as 41% of all public housing residents are children. And it's easy to imagine how this exposure might happen through shared ventilation systems and close proximity, making it easy for neighbors' secondhand smoke to seep through a child's bedroom and lungs. A two-prong approach to addressing this problem would be to make sure that when the multi-unit housing facility decides to protect all of its residents from secondhand smoke exposure, that the facility also provides tobacco cessation programs that are culturally appropriate for the residents living there, and ensure that all people can successfully be part of that effort to reduce tobacco exposure. All sectors, including education, are already making decisions in areas important for public health and by bringing them to the table. The different sectors that come together, such as education, that are very valuable by bringing unique and needed skill sets, expertise, and points of view to the mix, by leveraging resources and creating the type of buy-in that is needed for critical and sustainable change. Our local communities can help build momentum for healthy behaviors where Americans live, learn, work, and play. The goal is sustainable improvements that address the major risk factors for chronic disease, which are tobacco, physical activity, and unhealthy eating. We believe that our community health programs are really trying to ensure that by focusing on where people live, learn, work, and play, that from the moment when all hours of the day and night, that you really are having access to having a healthier lifestyle no matter where you are in our society. So here's a quick look at a map showing where all the communities that have been affected by our work over the last few years. This is a map showing our investments that had been over the last few years up to date as of January 2012. We have multiple programs that focus on reducing disparities and improving health at the local level. They include the racial and ethnic approaches to community health, or REACH program, which since 1999 has been a cornerstone of CDC's efforts to reduce health disparities. The Healthy Communities Program, which has supported 306 communities across all 50 states to prevent chronic diseases through coordinated efforts across a variety of different sectors, such as transportation, education, government, non-government, business, faith-based communities. The Communities Putting Prevention to Work Program, which drives local initiatives that are making healthy living easier for more than 50 million people. And the Community Transformation Grant Program, which in a moment I'll talk about in more in-depth. As you know better than anyone, health is essential to learning. Here are some quick examples of how we're helping them. Students cannot learn and thrive when they are sick. In Boston, Massachusetts, the Children's Asthma Initiative looked at a common cause of emergency room visits, school absences, and discomfort and fear for students, which was in asthma. Through the Reach Asthma Initiative, 800 children and families received case management services, and 610 children and families received at least one home visit. Program outcomes included a reduction in emergency department visits and inpatient admissions related to asthma. We've been able to determine that the return on investment with this effort was that for every dollar invested, nearly $1.46 was saved in direct medical or hospital savings. Additionally, we know that children learn best when their tummies are full of nutritious food and have time to burn off energy and move their bodies. These are just a few examples of how our programs have worked to improve the health of schools and children across the country. In the case of Bartholomew County, Indiana, the Farm to Fork program not only benefited the local farmers, but it also enabled the school to save money, as some local produce was cheaper than that shipped from out of state. Now I'd like to focus more on the CTG program, our newest program which has been rolling out all over the country over the last year. CDC has a strong focus on schools. We know that 91% of our implementation awardees include initiatives focused on K-12 populations or the school environment. The CTG program is reaching 1 in 3 U.S. citizens, or approximately 120 million Americans. We focus specifically on trying to achieve success through 5 strategic directions: tobacco-free living, active living and healthy eating, community clinical and other preventive services, social and emotional wellness, healthy and safe and physical environment. Among these, the awardees are required to focus on the first 3 strategic directions listed on this slide. I'd like to note, though, that we have found pretty much universally that social and emotional wellness and healthy and safe physical environment are both strategies that are being addressed while the grantees are addressing the first 3 strategic directions. So it's not that they have been overlooked or left out. We very much know that talking about working on strategies to improve healthy and safe physical environments is one of the approaches for ensuring that people are able to access an active living lifestyle. There are 67 CTG awardees. These are 29 counties with populations greater than 500,000, 24 state programs and states, and that includes 10 states that are serving every community throughout the state, and 14 states that are serving the communities in their state, minus the counties in their state that have a population of over 500,000. There are 7 American Indian Alaska Native tribes or tribal organizations, there's 1 territory Palau, and 6 national networks of community-based organizations, which are helping to disseminate and amplify the proven strategies of the CTG programs across the country, with an especial focus on rural and frontier areas and reducing health disparities. Roughly 20% of the CTG funding went to nonprofit or non-governmental organizations. And the 61 awardees that are in state and local communities are working across 36 different states. This map provides a visual representation of all the CTG-specific awarded communities and states, including, and I'd like to specifically highlight that there are the 7 American Indian Alaska Native tribes that are noted on this map through the triangles. And I'd also like to note that it's very important to focus on rural and frontier areas due to the limited transportation and areas with significant shortages of health professionals. In addition, we know that in rural and frontier parts of the country, poverty, culture barriers, and other factors such as low literacy rates contribute to health disparities and higher rates of chronic disease. With that, 20% of all CTG funding is directed to rural or frontier areas. The CTG program is to run for 5 years. We have many high expectations for the 5-year outcomes for CTG, and they're focused on increasing access to smoke-free and tobacco-free environments, healthy food and beverage options, physical activity opportunities, and the systems are opportunities that support control of chronic diseases, such as high blood pressure, cholesterol control, and asthma. Now I'd like to bring your attention briefly to some of the examples that we see around the country of where we expect there to be some great successes in the future as a result of the CTG program. Over the next few slides, I'll just show you a little bit of information along some of these areas that we're working and just highlight one of the the activities that's going on in that community and didn't. For instance, here for tobacco-free living, you can see that in South Dakota, we expect that by 2016, 265,000 additional people will be protected from secondhand smoke exposure, with a special emphasis on K-12 outdoor spaces and ensuring that at recreational and sporting venues, that people will not have to suffer from exposure to tobacco. Another part of this South Dakota initiative will be working with the Tribal and Bureau Indian of Education Affairs in K-12 schools to implement efforts to protect people from tobacco exposure on the buildings and grounds of those schools and increase the number from the current number of 7 schools that have some of those policies in place to 22. For active living impact, one of the exciting initiatives that's going on in Iowa, we believe that by 2016, 1.3 million Iowans will have improved access to healthy and safe physical environments. Some of the ways that they're trying to accomplish that goal is through their Fit for Life initiative, where they're working to develop, they have developed a tool to assess the walkability of communities, and then they're working with those communities to ensure that those assessments are informing strategies that will be implemented in the communities to make their communities more walking friendly. Additionally, the Iowa Department of Public Health created the Iowa Walking and Logistics Kit for Safe Routes to Schools initiative. And this iWalk uses global GPS system to map routes that children walk or bike to school every day and identify barriers and possible solutions for those routes to make it safer for children to get to school through physical activity. In the area of healthy living, let's take a second to look at New Mexico. New Mexico is taking a multifaceted approach to improving school nutrition, ensuring healthy foods are available and limiting less healthy foods, specifically by working with school districts to limit school milk to offerings of only 1% in skim milk, making water readily available during the school day, purchasing healthier options from New Mexico's USDA School Meals Entitlement Commodity Purchase Program, purchasing locally grown foods through the Farm to School program, and requiring healthy options for school snacks and school events, including athletic events. In the area of community and clinical preventive services, we know that looking at the systems that support the delivery of clinical care is a priority for CTG. Here you can see in Denver that we're trying to extend the reach of physicians through the use of community health workers, who are including a focus on asthma disease management, amongst other initiatives looking at the systems of primary care and figuring out how we can make it more accessible to more people and ensure that we have a special focus specifically on controlling cholesterol and high blood pressure. These are just a few examples of some of the great successes that we anticipate from CTG in the future, and I hope that they provide you a little bit of information to see what might be possible in your own community and how you might be able to get involved by looking at where the different communities are, these activities are taking place. But I'd also like to note that the strategies that the CTG program is putting forward don't necessarily require federal funding at all times and are ones that can be implemented by anyone. The mom that wants to make sure that their school has nutritious food offerings for their children can get involved with their PTA and ensure that they've brought in a farm to school initiative or that there is a salad bar on their school lunch line. We very much believe that there's a lot to be learned from the strategies that have been implemented in these programs and that through a multi-sector approach, bringing together our partners in education and business and the clinical setting amongst many others, there are many ways that these efforts can be accomplished throughout the country to ensure that all Americans have access to healthier lifestyles. And with that, I'll just mention that if you wanted to find out more information about all of our programs, our division, the Division of Community Health at CDC, website does have access to finding out more information about our Community Transformation Grants Program, the REACH Program, the Communities Putting Prevention to Work Program, and the Healthy Communities Program that I mentioned briefly earlier on in our presentation. Thank you very much, and we really appreciate all of your work that you do in schools around the country to protect our children.
Thank you so much, Sara, for your presentation, and particularly for all of the really helpful and relevant examples that you were able to provide. We're going to open it up for about 15 minutes, maybe a couple minutes fewer than that, for a Q&A. And so this is a reminder that if you would like to submit a question, please do so on the right panel of your screen, and we will try to get through as many questions as we are able. Okay, so, oh, and just, sorry, one other quick note. I have received some comments that some of you may have had difficulty hearing some of the audio portions of this presentation, and I want to let all of the participants know that we will be sending a follow-up email with the PowerPoint presentations that you've seen today. So hopefully that will be helpful. And I am going to make sure that all of the presenters are unmuted. One second. Okay, so I think the first question I'll direct to Sara, but Jeff or Donna, please feel free to chime in. Stacy writes, I'm a school nurse in Alaska. In rural Alaskan communities, milk can cost upwards of $8 a gallon. Fresh fruits and vegetables are rarely available, and when they are available, they are unaffordable. How do you propose increasing access to nutritious, healthy foods in rural areas such as these?
Well, Stacy, I think that's a great question and a challenge that we know that we are all facing in our rural and frontier areas of the country. One of the reasons why CTG has a mandate and why we are very committed to focusing on addressing the challenges in rural and frontier areas is because we know there's a lot of work to do to figure out what are the best strategies for solving some of the challenges in rural communities. I've worked extensively with Alaskan communities, and I know it is quite a challenge to ensure year-round access to fresh fruits and vegetables. Unfortunately, at this time, I don't have the easy answer for how we can do that, but we do believe that through the multi-sector approach of working with a variety of partners, and I know there are some of these systems that are across Alaska, that we hope that we will be able to provide greater access to those fruits and vegetables. We have seen some success in some of the farm-to-school initiatives, and I think it would be worth following up with them and maybe with CDC to see if we could provide you some better resources and access to some of the emerging strategies that might work in rural frontier areas. But again, I think we hear you, and we know that it is a big challenge, and we also are trying to figure out how we can make it easier in our frontier communities.
Thank you, Sara. Okay, so Christy from, I'm not sure where she's from, but Sara, this looks like another good question for you. She asks, how do we find out who currently has received community transformation grants and what strategies they're using?
Great, thank you, Christy, for that question. So currently on the website that I put up, which or you can go to www.cdc.gov/community-transformation. That's the CTG website directly, and you can find a list of all the current funded awardees for the CTG program. And on that, you can find a map and who those organizations are. There's a little bit of information about what the intentions were of those grantees when they began the program back in October. We are hoping to have more information, but also about some of the detailed strategies they're working on in the very near future. But in the interim, I would encourage that if you see that there is a grantee in your backyard, that we would be happy to help facilitate connecting you with them so that you could find out more details about their work that's going on the ground.
Thank you, Sara. And as a follow-up, I have a number of questions from people who are wondering if there are currently community grants available or opportunities. How do they find out more about opportunities in the future for funding requests?
Great, I'm glad you brought that up, and I should have mentioned that on my slides. We currently at CDC, we have three funding opportunity announcements that were announced in June. There's one for the Community Transformation Grant Small Communities Grant Program. That initiative has gone out, it has a special focus on working with health and non-health organizations. The letters of intent for those applications were already passed due, but the applications are due on July 31st. There's more information about that funding opportunity announcement also on the website of Community Transformation Grants that I just mentioned. In addition, there are two other funding opportunity announcements associated with the REACH program, or the Racial and Ethnic Approaches to Community Health. Both of those initiatives have a focus on reducing health disparities, and those applications are due pretty soon, also in early August. And you could find out more information about those on our website.
Thank you, Sara. And now, Donna, a question for you. Shirley writes, how can school nurses promote prevention strategies in their schools, especially when there are current budget issues in states across this country?
Thank you for that question, Angela. And I think that the big message is school nurses can't do it alone, but in partnering with those who may be in the community, who may have community transformation grants or REACH grants, those who may be in the health departments, looking for hospitals that provide community benefits who may be able to help with prevention strategies and even coming up with some ways that prevention can happen in schools. It really is a matter of seeing who's in your community that you can perhaps reach out with to extend your emphasis on prevention.
Thank you, Donna. Let's see. Again, please keep submitting your questions on the right panel, and we will try to get to them. Beth writes, and I think this one is again for you, Donna. Beth writes, thanks for acknowledging the care coordination work that school nurses provide. Do you see funding to support this at the federal level, and if so, from who?
That's a very good question, and I think it's the answer is multi-pronged, and some of those answers we have and some are going to emerge. The Centers for Medicare and Medicaid recently awarded two rounds of innovation grants, and reading those who were awarded those grants, there are some activities done on behalf of children's health and managing chronic illnesses in children, and I think that what we have to do is look at those opportunities when they come around and partner again with those who may be able to help us develop really strong grant applications for that kind of work. And the other thing that's very important and that NASN is looking at and working with others on is looking at the funding for healthcare that happens to occur in a school setting. And I think the Affordable Care Act does open up some opportunities for looking at how that care can happen. We've talked to individuals at Health and Human Services related to making sure that accountable care organizations have some opening and some ability for schools to look at how healthcare delivery done in those settings can be part of those affordable care accountable care organizations. So there's many prongs to reaching out for making sure that care for children who have chronic health problems and who go to school have that care paid for. We don't have all the answers right now, but we're working on that.
Thank you, Donna. And Jeff, here's a good question for you. Someone is interested to know about how the election results in November may or may not influence these opportunities that we've been discussing today, the Prevention and Public Health Fund and the Community Transformation Grant.
Well, I think, you know, a lot, I think that's a good question, and I wish I knew the answer. Clearly, you know, these are initiatives that have been supported by the current administration. And have been subject to some pretty partisan debate. I would like to think when the dust settles after November that everyone will take a deep breath and regardless of the outcome of the election and what people may think of some of the underlying parts of the Affordable Care Act, a continued investment in prevention and a continued investment in programs like the Community Transformation Grants will continue. But it's going to take a lot of convincing from all of us about the value of this in our communities to create that broad base of support.
Thank you, Jeff. Sorry, there are so many questions. I'm trying to go through them. let's see, the next question comes from Beth, who, again, Don, I think this might be appropriate for you to respond to. She asks, are there grants in these prevention initiatives to support an electronic health record system for school nurses and integrate electronic health records with community systems?
I think that's a very good question, and that's one that I don't have an immediate answer for, but one that we're looking at and actively working on. NASN has appointed an informatics committee to begin looking at that information, so stay tuned for more news about that.
Thank you, Donna. Okay. Let's see, we have a couple minutes left, and just going through these questions. Donna, someone writes, school nurse positions are being cut due to budgetary constraints. How can we ensure sustainable, dedicated funding to keep the school nurse positions viable? School-based health centers have gotten some funding from the Affordable Care Act, but not school nursing. In addition to community transformation grants, can we find ways to partner with the private sector with insurance companies?
That's a very good question, and it's actually something that NASN has been actively looking at, working with other groups, in fact, to see how the care that children need happens and not have that care at the mercy of education budgets. It's real important that health care that is done in schools is paid for with health care dollars and not just education dollars. There's not an immediate answer to how that will happen, but we're actively working with others to make sure that children get the health care that they deserve, and we believe that children deserve a school nurse to lead that health care team.
Angela, this is Sara Zeigler. If I could offer another, an additional thought too?
Absolutely.
One of the things I think, besides some of the community transformation grant work and the work the CDC is doing, I think it's important for folks to know that there are broader efforts going on around the country related to community benefits. And while that is a complicated story to bring up with the minute left in the webinar, I wanted to make sure folks were aware that there's a lot of work going on with hospital associations and other non-governmental partners and local communities to ascertain what are the opportunities to improve health across clinical and public health and in education with many sectors. And so while CTG may not be in everybody's backyard, there is a movement across the country for a number of different initiatives that have been amplified and accelerated with the Affordable Care Act that may provide additional opportunities to leverage resources and focus priorities in any one community more comprehensively around some important issues like support for school nurses. And so it might be worth as one of the follow-ups that we might be able to provide some more information about what's happening in communities around the community, establishing community benefits work that's going on with hospital associations as a result of some of the new regulations that have come out of the Affordable Care Act.
I think that's really helpful, Sara. Thank you so much. And I know that we're out of time, but I'm going to end with one final question that's directed to Dr. Levy. Beverly writes, I firmly believe that the school setting is ideal for most initiatives involving children in the U.S. Will we see more collaborative projects with the NASN? And I guess our answer is we sure hope so.
And I think that's a logical and reasonable hope. And certainly at the community level, engaging schools and engaging school nurses is going to be critical to achieving a lot of these outcomes.
We couldn't agree more. Thank you again so much to our wonderful panelists today and to all of the participants who joined us for this very important conversation.